the U.S. Navy was the first to market with radar. We had it at an advanced state of development relative to the Japanese. We had begun to figure out how to use it, and we made use of it at the Battle of Midway.
And so you have these radio physicists in the 1920s who are experimenting with new wavelengths in the electromagnetic spectrum. And they're working really hard to help the Navy advance into high frequency radio propagation so that they can have sets that are effective there. And while they're thinking about potential applications, they have a couple interesting incidents when they're experimenting with these new hardware systems.
You know, the radio division was focused on radio, and in doing radio experiments, they noticed the effect of a ship passing in front of the radio. And they made the connection, the scientists at the time made the connection that this could be of use for detecting things when you could not visually see them.
And so now the challenge with radar is not just they have this initial observation, this interesting field observation that was not intended. And then the challenge for them for the next 10 years is trying to make that reliable and trying to make the readout of that information useful to people in the Navy on ships.
There was this continual push to operate higher frequencies and move to higher powers to detect targets at longer ranges. And that culminated in the work that led to the first XAF, the first radar prototype.
The XAF was the first time they could take it, put it on a ship, demonstrate detection of aircraft at long ranges, and show the Navy, naval officers, what this new technique could provide them.
So Page and the other NRL physicists and engineers take radar to sea for the first time in 1938, and this is the XAF radar system. And this is their first opportunity to see how radar operates in an actual Navy environment. They're taking it out of the labs and they're putting it on a ship. So there's this question of whether or not the Navy's going to have space for this in a lot of regards, and whether or not they will accept this new tool and they view it as a viable new tool in the form that it's in right now. And so what's really exciting is that you have these officers who were part of the fleet exercises, and they write their own endorsements of this new system, and they send it to the head of the Atlantic Fleet, Admiral Johnson, and Admiral Johnson adds his endorsement to the viability of this stopgap prototype radar that's already being fielded. And he says the XAF equipment is one of the most important military developments since the advent of radio itself. He says the development of the equipment is such as to make it now a permanent installation in cruisers and carriers. And so he's advocating that even in the condition that it's in, even though they're still working to improve and refine the system, he realizes the utility of even having this early generation radar set on as many cruisers and carriers as they can produce them for. And that is the decision point at which XAF goes into limited batch production, and that's the CXAM that sees service in World War II and at Midway. Midway demonstrates that the radar systems can effectively provide early warning to the ships.
It helped in destroying a lot of the enemy aircraft. Otherwise, we wouldn't have known, we would have been under surprise. We wouldn't have seen them until much closer ranges, wouldn't have had our aircraft in the right spot. So it was clear that it was really instrumental in helping the fleet do as well as it did at the Battle of Midway.
Radar certainly was a factor in that it allowed us to know when the Japanese aircraft were approaching our ships, our aircraft carriers, and allowed those aircraft carriers, the Yorktown in particular, to become prepared. The Japanese had no such warning. They did not have the radar. They had to rely on visual detection, and they did not get a warning. They engaged our attacking aircraft over the ships, or as they approached the ships. And we enjoyed the advantage due to radar of knowing when their attacking aircraft were coming.
The Navy officers working with this new equipment recognize its potential at Midway, and they recognize that it did have a tactical impact, and it did improve their situational awareness. It improved their ability to make sense of the nature and distribution of their threats.
A lot of the problems and lessons and uses of radar, the way radar was used in World War II and at Midway, are still applicable today. Rapid prototyping is still being used today. We've done that similar things with the SPS-49, the AN-SPOOK 9B, that where we developed prototypes, demonstrated key capabilities, and transitioned those capabilities to industry to produce them in quantity to make them something that the Navy could take and use and have operated by sailors.
Building prototype systems, working with the fleet, working with the acquisition community, and in that way, moving our ideas across that boundary into actual operational use. And they were doing the exact same thing that we continue to do today. It's a great model for how NRL continues to advance technologies and move them into the fleet rapidly.